Before we get to our tutorials for this week, let's talk about some of your options in importing your images to your computer so you can work with them.
With any sort of camera you can use a USB or FireWire cable to connect your camera to your computer and transfer your image onto it. Alternatively, if your camera has an SD memory card and your computer has a port for it, you can take out the memory card from your camera, plug it into your computer, and transfer your files that way. If you're using a camera phone or other device and you don't have the ability to use any of the previous methods, perhaps you can email your files to yourself and download them to your computer in order to work with them. If you don't have a camera for still images, yet you have a video camera, you can export still images from your video, which you can then open in Photoshop or GIMP and build your project from there. When using your camera, check its settings for the highest possible resolution setting in pixel dimensions. Try to have good lighting in your shots to avoid grainy artifacts showing up in your images when you attempt to color correct them. If your camera has the ability to capture RAW files, go with this option. This will generate very large files, which will have a lot of information embedded in them. When you bring your RAW files into your computer, you will see them bearing the extension .RAW or .DNG or .CR2, or they could have a number of other RAW format extensions. If you are using Photoshop, once you double-click on the RAW file you brought in, you will get this special window, which is actually a separate program distributed along with Photoshop. It's called Adobe Camera Raw, and it gives you the opportunity to manipulate your image before you bring it into Photoshop. The reason is because a RAW file hides so much information, much like film negatives do. An image you capture, which may seem to be lacking detail in its highlights, for example, might actually have all that information and you can recover it if you captured the shot in RAW format and you open it with Adobe Camera Raw. This will open automatically if you double-click on your RAW file and you have Photoshop installed on your machine. The interface of Adobe Camera Raw will right away give you the opportunity to make adjustments with just a few sliders, which you can play with even by trial and error, which will correct your image in ways Photoshop would not be able to perform. The preview area will always display the state of your image based on any changes you've made. As soon as you're happy with the result, just as a starting point, you can click on Open Image, and your image will now open in Photoshop, where you can continue working. Any alterations you have made with the sliders within the Adobe Camera Raw interface will not damage your RAW files. Your RAW file will always maintain the original information it captured when you took the shot. GIMP users working with RAW files will need to download and install a plugin called UF Raw. With this, you can process your RAW files and then open them in GIMP. If you have access to a scanner and you have material you would like to scan and incorporate into your work, you will need to make sure there is a scanner driver installed on your machine, which you can open. It would open like any other program, where you can choose your settings for the scan. If a scanner driver is not already installed on your computer for this purpose, you will need to search for the manufacturer and model of the scanner you have, along with the word drivers. Download the appropriate driver and run it. In the settings window, try to choose the advanced or professional mode if available. There you can indicate if you're scanning a reflective surface, something like printed images, or if you're scanning film negatives or transparencies. There will be several drop-down lists for various settings. Try to make an educated choice for them. The important setting to watch out for is for the scan resolution. If you indicate 300 dpi and what your target size will be, that is how large you would want your resulting image to be, that should give you a pretty good result. If you don't want to specify a target document size, feel free to increase the scan resolution to a much higher number than 300 dpi, which will have a similar effect, scanning much more detail so you can potentially use your image at higher sizes than your original object size. In any case, you will need to find the manual for the device you have for instructions on how to use it most effectively for your purposes.